in case you missed it, Apple just quietly released an entirely new form of production workflow. But what makes this workflow so interesting is that Apple's now beginning to connect hardware and software tools together in a completely new way. And I think we're at the very beginning of an entirely new workflow ecosystem. And in a few years, it has the potential to dominate. So what is it? Well, Apple now lets you shoot on four iPhone 15 cameras at the same time, jam sync them together, connect an external mic, remotely control them, view them live, and transfer the recordings directly to a nonlinear editor. Come on, four cameras shooting 4K to an iPad? We gotta test this. To utilize this workflow, we first need to dig into the tools that are required. We'll start with the hardware. For production, you'll need an iPhone 15, and I strongly recommend the Pro or Pro Max models because they're currently the only way to capture using ProRes, which I'll explain later why that is more important than you think. A 15 Pro retails around $1,000 US. For post-production, you'll need the iPad Pro. The new M4 is the ideal device and retails for around $1,200 US. Now onto the software tools for this workflow. On the iPad, you'll need the new Final Cut Pro for iPad application. This editor is a subscription app, which will set you back $5 a month or $50 a year. Final Cut Pro for iPad is the most powerful mobile editor, and it not only has a ton of great features, it's optimized to run on the M4 chipset, which means it supports multicam in HDR using Apple's 12-bit finishing codec ProRes XQ. A lot of words there, but it's a big deal. And then comes the newest and most interesting part of this workflow. A month ago, Apple released a brand new camera application specifically built for multicam called Final Cut Camera. Final Cut Camera is a free app that is specially designed to sync up four unique iPhones directly into Final Cut Pro for iPad so you can control and shoot four cameras at the same time. Well, let's walk through the connection process. We start with Final Cut Pro for iPad and create a new project. This project is called Chef Mia. It's here where we can select a color space in either SDR or HLG. For the most control in post over dynamic range, you'll actually probably want to set this to SDR, which I know is confusing, but it's kind of related to that ProRes comment I made a moment ago. When it comes to frame rates, we have a bit of an issue though. Final Cut is fully capable of working in virtually any professional frame rate, but iPhone 15, not so much. Since it's a phone, it's tempting to give things like SMPTE frame accuracy a pass, but this is now a multicam shoot, so accurate timecode now matters. iPhones today prefer true frame rates, so in this case, true 24. So if you're running separate audio, definitely set these to true 24, 30, or 60, and not NTSC 2398, 2997, or 5994, or you risk having audio drifts. Then we can choose our storage location. iPad Pro has a USB-C port which supports external drives, making it easy to store and share lots of footage. We've tested the Samsung T7 SSD. We can set our project resolution, which can be customized in portrait or landscape up to DCI 4K. For 16:9, we'll use UHD settings. Now that our project is set up, we can click continue, and we have a new panel which allows us to record with a live multicam. This automatically launches an angles panel, which is where we connect our iPhone 15 Pro cameras. You'll need to put the iPad and the cameras on the same wireless network, but you do not need to be connected to the internet for this to work. Then you have to make your iPhone discoverable. iPhone security has tightened nearly to the point of annoying, so the easiest way to do this is to open your iPhone settings panel, long press on the Wi-Fi, then set AirDrop to everyone for 10 minutes. Once a connection is established, you shouldn't need to do this weird step in the future. Next, we go to the new Final Cut camera app. Click on the sync icon. Final Cut Pro is now negotiating a connection with Final Cut Camera. To enable access, you'll get a four-digit pairing code. That looks familiar. And then you can click allow. Now your phone becomes a known device. Known devices will be saved here, and you have a choice to let those devices automatically reconnect your projects in the future. You can repeat these steps for all four cameras and even name your camera angles to A, B, C, and D, or name the angle type, such as center, close-up, top, or side. Given there can be connection bumps in the road, naming here will help you isolate which cameras need attention. Once we're finished, we can now see all four cameras automatically synced together and wirelessly transmitting video to the iPad. Latency is impressive, about 50 milliseconds or less than 2 frames. But while latency is often really reliable, when you have 4 cameras on a crowded network, it can start to break down and the lag can significantly increase. So be ready to troubleshoot wireless video and do some testing of your own network performance and configurations, especially since there can be easily a dozen devices sharing that network. Take a moment here and consider that this is already an impressive tool, but we can see the cameras don't quite match. To address this, click on the expand icon in the lower right of a camera angle. This will take you to full screen, which is required to configure the camera settings. At the top, you can control the codec. Again, ProRes is only available in the iPhone 15 Pro and Pro Max models, and you're gonna want that because if you switch to the color science, ProRes is required to enable log. One of the biggest hardware upgrades to iPhone 15 was the addition of USB-C. For the most flexible workflow, I recommend using external record drives. We've been using the Sabrent Nano Rockets and the Samsung T7 SSDs. These are fast, reliable, small, and I like that they have rubber cases. When you connect the drive, iPhone will automatically show you the USB connection and provide an estimate of how much footage you can record on that available disk. But this menu is only visible locally on the camera, so you can't see your storage status on the iPad when you're monitoring during the shoot. This is a big issue for me, and I expect Apple to address this in the future. Shooting to an external drive is almost certainly required when capturing log, but for this initial test, I'm gonna leave this in HEVC mode, so later I can show you the differences between ProRes and HEVC. Next, we can select our resolution and our frames per second, which you'll see only support true 24, 25, or 30, as we discussed. Once we've set these up, we can also control our focus to be automatic or driven remotely using the touchscreen. We can set our shutter to 1/48, select the ideal setting for our target ISO, and then we can select an exact white balance to match our lighting conditions. We can even change the lenses and control the camera zoom remotely, which, by the way, has a throttle, so you can slowly zoom in and zoom out while shooting live. To help get the best images possible, if you go to the settings menu and select tools, you can enable grid overlays and enable some exposure and peaking tools. There's lots of room in this menu, and I expect that will eventually be filled with some new features. I certainly have some ideas. These tools are only displayed on the live video feed and are not recorded onto the picture. It's also here that you can run a separate audio system and record your sound without using the camera mic. To do this, you'll need more USB-C ports. We used a Belkin 4-port USB-C splitter, which costs about $40 US. This splitter let us connect our external drive as well as our Rode Wireless Go lavalier, which retails for about $300 US. This device passes power, so you could power through the splitter with all these devices attached. One issue is you can't configure all the cameras at the same time. So I expect that to be an update since I would love the ability to adjust the settings across all the cameras simultaneously. But for now, you'll need to manually set up each camera with matching settings. Once you've done that, since Final Cut has remote control, we can use it to actually trigger record and stop with all 4 cameras at the same time. And now we can hit cut and check this out. It's already giving us the indication that it's ready to transfer the media. This is the case on all 4 cameras, which show you that a transfer is in progress. You do not need to transfer the files since they're on the local SSDs, but if you're shooting HEVC, Final Cut will media manage for you by moving all 4 camera recordings to your iPad drive. Once that's complete, I can switch back to the editor and the clip appears. From there, I can drag and drop this clip directly into a timeline. And at the bottom of Final Cut is a button labeled Multicam. And now we can see all 4 angles playing back in 4K with timecode accuracy. Simply by clicking our B, C, and D angles, we can switch between each camera and the timeline will reflect our edits. Now, let's just pause here for a second. We just set up 4 cameras in 4K, synced them together as multicams with wireless video, connected external audio, remotely triggered record, and wirelessly transferred the results to an NLE where we had 4 angles of 4K playing back with live switching. This is what I mean when I said Apple is building a new production and post-production ecosystem. When people make arguments about using iPhones as cameras, they tend to orient their complaints around the ergonomics and the limited lens control. I agree with those concerns, and they're certainly worth testing, which is why you should check out some other videos on this channel, which contain some of the most in-depth iPhone analyses on the internet. But what I've been trying to explain is that while images out of iPhones will continue to show consistent improvements, the biggest differentiator is not going to be in images. It's going to be found in the ecosystem, the workflow, which is how hardware and software tools fit together. There's a lot of manufacturers out there, and most of them continue building on the same routine paths that have worked for decades. But the world of media and entertainment, it's changing, and companies like Apple and Blackmagic are innovating on a different path. Today, it might not be obvious, but 5 years from now, a workflow-driven strategy to product design is going to transform the entire landscape. Sure, you can shoot today with four mirrorless cameras, and maybe you have a way to jam sync them all together, but configure those camera settings remotely and control focus and exposure remotely and set up wireless monitoring feeds remotely and deliver clips to an NLE wirelessly in seconds? Well, the products that do that, there are very few. What we're seeing with Final Cut Camera is new, and for the right project, someday it might be ideal. But with all that Final Cut Camera offers, it's far from perfect. This new workflow is not without its issues, its limitations, and its not so obvious gotchas. In fact, that ProRes issue I keep talking about, it's a big deal. So now that we've gone over how to configure Final Cut Camera, in our next episode, we put it to the test, and we're gonna show you what else you need to configure and what you need to invest in to get the best results.